Ambassador Stanley Lo of Singapore, Mr. Zhai Jing Fu, Counselor of the Embassy of the People's Republic of China, Mr. Go Sing Tech, Mrs. Ko, distinguished guests from the Foreign Ministry, Diplomatic Corps, and the press, fellows and students of Tembusu College and other colleges, ladies and gentlemen, welcome. This event tonight initiates the fifth year of the Tembusu Forum series, which is the flagship event of Tembusu College. Twice a semester on average, that's four times a year, we bring distinguished guest panels addressing some of the most important issues, or in this case, milestones, to primarily undergraduate audiences. That last distinction makes the forum unique in Singapore and possibly, or at least very uncommon, in the rest of the world. When the microphones are open for questions, we invite the undergraduates, not the professors, even freshmen, to the microphones first. And then my apologies in advance to members of the press. Although to you students, you have the chance to make news tonight with your searching questions because we have so many distinguished journalists with us tonight in the hall. Now, as I've done for 15 times before by my count, it's my great pleasure to invite to the podium the founder and convener of the Tembusu Forum, a man who gives so much of himself to the college, even beyond this event series, our esteemed rector, Professor Tommy Ko.
Thank you very much, Greg. Ambassador Stanley Lo, Councillor Zai Xingfu, Mr. Go Sing Tek, the editor of Lianhe Zaobao, many distinguished friends who are here, fellow Tembusians. I join Professor Clancy in welcoming you to this happy event. A few months ago, we held a Tembusu Forum to celebrate the 50th anniversary of the establishment of diplomatic relations between India and Singapore. It was a very successful forum. This evening, we have the pleasure of celebrating the 25th anniversary of the establishment of diplomatic relations between our two countries. my own involvement in the development of bilateral relations between China and Singapore began in New York in 1974. In that year, I was posted back to the UN for the second time as our permanent representative. One of the jobs I was given was to establish a dialogue with the very distinguished Chinese permanent representative, Ambassador Huang Hua, who would later become the Foreign Minister of China. The UN was our contact point with China between 1974 and 1976. On the 7th of October, 1974, our then Foreign Minister, Mr. Rajaratnam, hosted a dinner in honor of the leader of the Chinese delegation to the UN General Assembly, Vice Foreign Minister Chow Guanhua. The dinner went very well, and at the end of the dinner, Minister Chow invited Mr. Rajaratnam to lead a goodwill delegation to visit China. Ambassador Huang Hua and I worked hard to prepare this trip, and the visit took place in the following year from the 13th to the 22nd of March, 1975. On the 17th of March, the Singapore delegation called on the Chinese Premier, the much-loved Zhou Enlai. In 1976, Ambassador Huang Hua and I organized the first visit to China by our founding Prime Minister, Mr. Lee Kuan Yew. And that trip took place from the 10th to the 24th of May, 1976. The highlight of the trip was a call by Mr. Lee on Chairman Mao. In 1990, I had returned to Singapore from Washington, D.C. And one of my first assignments was to lead a delegation to negotiate an agreement with China for the establishment of diplomatic relations between China and Singapore. The members of the Singapore delegation include three good friends who are here with us this evening, Mr. Chan Heng Wing, Mr. Ang Che Chuan, and Mr. Li Hui Huan. Can you please stand? Another member of the delegation, Mr. Lee Chong Yam, was supposed to join us this evening, but he's been taken ill and is not able to join us. Yet another member of the delegation, Mr. Jackie Fu, is our current Consul General in Hong Kong, and he was also not able to join us. I regret to say that another two members of that delegation, Mr. S. Tiwari and Mr. Wong Ming Kwang, have passed away. I've asked Margaret to show us a picture of the Singapore delegation. We were all looking very young then, taken in the beautiful ground of Diao Yi Tai in Beijing. The negotiations took three rounds. The first and third rounds of the negotiation took place in this beautiful and very scenic spot, Diao Yi Tai in Beijing. The second round took place in Singapore. The negotiations were successfully concluded on the 18th of September, 1990, in Beijing. And there is a photo, which I will now show you, of the leader of the Chinese delegation, Mr. Xu Tunxin, the then Vice Foreign Minister, and I shaking hands. This was quite late at night, I remember, when we successfully concluded the negotiations. The agreement that we negotiated in September was signed at the United Nations on the 3rd of October, 1990, by the then Chinese Foreign Minister, Chen Qicheng, and the then Singapore Foreign Minister, Wong Kang Sing. I had invited Mr. Wong to join us this evening, but he is unfortunately also not available. 15 years after this, I was given another assignment that has to do with China. My then Foreign Minister, Mr. George Ho, appointed me to represent Singapore in the ASEAN-China Group of Eminent Persons. And the group was co-chaired by the former Foreign Minister of China, Chen Qicheng, and the former Deputy Prime Minister of Malaysia, Tan Sri Musa Hitam. I was, of course, very happy to see Mr. Chen again after an absence of 15 years because he was foreign minister when the negotiations in 1990 took place. And Heng Wing, Chie Chuan, and Hui Huan will remember that when the negotiations were stuck during the third round, we had requested a meeting with Foreign Minister Chen and appealed to him to give a new mandate to the Chinese delegation. Finally, I now co-chair the China-Singapore Forum, a track 1.5 meeting of public intellectuals between our two countries that meet annually and alternate between Singapore and China. I will be going to China in October this year. My Chinese co-chair is a very distinguished Chinese diplomat, Mr. Yang Wenchang, the president of the Chinese People's Institute of Foreign Affairs, a former vice minister and a former ambassador to Singapore. So that is a brief recital of my happy involvement in the development of good relations between our two countries. It now gives me very great pleasure to request our young and very capable ambassador to China, Ambassador Stanley Lo, to speak to us. Mr. Lo was recently given the Public Administration Gold Medal for his outstanding work. Stanley, please.
Professor Tommy Koh, my guru. I've known Professor Koh since the first day I joined the Foreign Ministry when I was in charge of Malaysia. And my very first mission, which was then a secret, but no longer a secret now, was to carry the professor's bag on a secret trip to London to discuss, to meet our Queen's Council on Petra Branca. So, as you can see, I have learnt a lot from the professor over the last 20 years. And Professor Greg Clancy, Counselor Zai Xing Fu, my good friend, Mr. Goh Sin Teck, whom we have pulled away from very important domestic matters in Sao Pao to very important foreign affairs matters here. And my colleagues, the former ambassadors, former consul generals from the Singapore Diplomatic Service, who have all contributed to China. And last but not least, you know, the very important audience here today, my fellow members of NUS. It feels very good to be able to come back to NUS again and to see University Town, which was not here when I was studying in NUS. So good evening to all of you. It gives me great pleasure to be back here. And it also gives me a lot of pleasure to note that of the three Singapore speakers today, including Professor Koh, we are all members of the NUS family. So that says something about NUS. There's a Chinese saying, 前人种树，后人乘凉. So it's thanks to the efforts of Professor Koh and my colleagues earlier that today we are able to enjoy the shade and we are able to be here to attend this forum on the 25th anniversary of Sino-Singapore diplomatic relations. Although Singapore and China only established diplomatic relations in 1990, people-level relations actually date back many centuries. Since the 1800s, many Chinese have ventured from the mainland to Singapore as part of what was then called the Xia Nanyang wave to seek a better living. In fact, Dr. Sun Yat-sen had visited Singapore 9 times, and he made Singapore the headquarters in Nanyang of the Tong Meng Hui. So you may ask, why then, despite all these deep historical ties, why then did Singapore only establish diplomatic relations with China in 1990? After we had been independent since 1965? Well, when Singapore gained independence in 1965, our relationship with China was very difficult and complex because of the geopolitics of the Cold War. China also did not have good relations with our larger neighbors. And many of our larger neighbors perceived Singapore as a 小中国, mini China, simply because we have an ethnic Chinese majority. Singapore therefore had to tread very carefully and make clear that we acted entirely based on our own national interests as a sovereign and independent country. The late Mr. Lee Kuan Yew therefore wisely decided that Singapore will be the very last of the original founding members of ASEAN to establish diplomatic relations with China. But the absence of formal diplomatic relations did not hinder our bilateral interactions with China. Mr. Lee Kuan Yew visited China in 1976 before we had formal diplomatic relations. And Mr. Deng Xiaoping visited Singapore in 1978. And we treated the two leaders' visit with great respect and gave them high honors as though they were state visits, even though we did not have diplomatic relations. This was very unusual. Mr. Deng was impressed by what he saw in Singapore, and he felt that Singapore was a useful reference point for China's reforms and opening up. So after the two visits, China's impressions of Singapore changed dramatically. And my friends, the former Chinese ambassadors to Singapore, told me after that, thousands of Chinese officials and cadres all came, you know, in droves to meet with us, to study this and to study that. And they couldn't handle it, too many. In 1989, China was shaken by the Tiananmen incident. This was a very difficult time for China. Notwithstanding this tide of negative international opinion against China, Mr. Lee decided to commence discussions with China to establish diplomatic relations. So as Professor Koh explained and recounted just now, on 3rd October 1990, Singapore and China formally established diplomatic relations. This was 1 month before Mr. Lee Kuan Yew handed over the premiership to Mr. Goh Chok Tong. Mr. Lee wanted to see this through. He wanted to show that Singapore was not a fair-weathered friend. And you can imagine, this was a very major decision and not something that a new prime minister would have been able to do so easily. So Mr. Lee Kuan Yew wanted to see it through. So over a short span of 25 years, relations between our two countries have developed quickly in scope and in substance. Since 2013, Singapore has been China's largest foreign investor on an annual basis, while China became Singapore's largest trading partner. In 1990, when we established diplomatic relations, bilateral trade was only $5.2 billion. By 2014, it had increased by more than 16.5 times to $86 billion. In 1990, Singapore's FDI into China was just $50 million US. Last year, it was $5.8 billion US. And we have accumulated more than $72 billion. So small little Singapore, only 5 million of us, largest investor in China. That's quite remarkable. In terms of people movement, people exchanges, tourism, in 1990, both ways, we add them together, there were only 100,000 tourists going both ways. Last year, 2.7 million. So in 25 years, we have seen a huge increase, and we have done very well in terms of economic cooperation. The key characteristic of our relationship is that our bilateral cooperation has evolved with our changing needs and interests. In 1994, when China focused on attracting foreign investments and building modern industrial parks, Mr. Lee Kuan Yew proposed that we jointly develop the Suzhou Industrial Park. This was our first government-level project. Last year, we celebrated its 20th anniversary. It's become a successful model across China for industrial parks, and it's even started to replicate itself as far away as Xinjiang and in Anhui. That was the intention in the first place, not to build one park, but to build one model that could be replicated. In the year 2007, when China was putting more emphasis on sustainable development or eco-development, Singapore proposed that we jointly develop an eco-city. I was very fortunate at the time to be the press secretary to Senior Minister Goh, so I was present at that meeting. I remembered before the meeting, we thought, you know, this is a big proposal. So we thought that SM Goh would propose this to Premier Wen Jiabao. Premier Wen would say, well, we'll consider it, and then we'll have more discussions. But no, Premier Wen agreed immediately, and he said, I will be visiting Singapore for the ASEAN summits later this year, and I want to sign it. So he agreed immediately. The next day, we were in a central province in China. ESM was the guest of honor. Madam Wu Yi was then vice premier. She was the Chinese leader attending. And I remember she came running to ESM and she said, Wu Zizhen, 我听到了,总理跟我讲了,我们有一个新项目派我负责, in English. SM Go, the premier has told me we are going to start a new project and I'm in charge. So it was decided immediately. So we eventually picked Tianjin for the Eco City, and we have converted barren land. You know, before we built Eco City, there was nothing there, saline land. And we've converted it into a livable and environmentally friendly city. Today, it is home to 20,000 residents, and 2,000 registered companies, and the number is still growing. Some of you would have read about the Tianjin blast recently, and I'm pleased that the Echo City was not affected because it is a residential and commercial place, eco-friendly, so no dangerous substances. Other than the Suzhou Industrial Park and Tianjin Echo City, we have also established other major projects under a model that we call the private sector-led, government-supported model. The Guangzhou Knowledge City, which supports the upgrading of Guangzhou from being a manufacturing base to a knowledge-based economy. We have the Jilin Food Zone. We are interested in food security in China, in Singapore. So in Jilin, we are developing a food zone. We've just started. If it's successful, it will be a zone twice the size of Singapore for pigs. So there'll be a lot of pigs. So don't worry, there'll be a lot of pork. In Western China, to support the development of Western China, we have in Sichuan also a high-tech innovation park. So over the years, you can see our bilateral cooperation has changed thematically to suit the changing needs and interests. We have also expanded beyond traditional economic cooperation. And I want to highlight three: cadre training, financial services, and social governance. Cadre training. Singapore and China enjoy close cooperation in cadre training. Almost 50,000 Chinese cadres have attended training programs and study visits in Singapore since 1996. Some of them now are ministers and provincial party secretaries. So we have made a lot of friends through these programs. Initially, they were more interested in economic development subjects. But of late, we notice there's more interest in social governance, urban planning, and sustainable development. Financial services is another new area which has seen tremendous growth. Since the launch of RMBE clearing facilities in May 2013 in Singapore, we have become the largest offshore RMB hub outside of Greater China in terms of both deposits and transaction volume. We now offer a growing range of RMB products, including the Lien City bonds. Hong Kong has dim sum bonds, we have Lien City bonds. And the interest rates are much lower than on mainland China. Last year, SIP, Suzhou Industrial Park and Tianjin Echo City also launched a pilot program that allows for cross-border RMB transactions. So social governance is another new area. We have all been reading in the newspapers about the new Chinese leadership's emphasis on social governance, rule of law, anti-corruption. China is undertaking major reforms in these areas, and Singapore is one of several reference points for China. Bilateral relations aside, Singapore has always adopted the principled position and played a constructive role in regional affairs. In cross-strait relations, we have always abided by our One China policy and supported direct dialogue and cooperation between the two sides of the Taiwan Strait. In 1993, when the mainland and Taiwan wanted to hold direct dialogue, but were unable to agree on whether to do so in Beijing or Taipei, Singapore provided some tables and chairs. So we were a neutral venue for the inaugural Wang Ku talks. The Wang Ku talks had helped to cement what is now called the 92 consensus, 92 Gongshi, which continues to serve as a foundation for cross-strait engagement until today. More recently, we were the first to launch negotiations for an economic partnership agreement with Chinese Taipei in 2011. In doing so, we helped to establish a workable model for such agreements between Chinese Taipei and other WTO members, and a model that is acceptable to all parties. Over the years, Singapore has supported China's integration into the international system through participation in multilateral organizations, such as WTO, ASEAN, and other organizations. Singapore leaders have always encouraged Western countries to engage China. When the ASEAN-China Free Trade Agreement was first proposed, we helped to assuage the concerns of our fellow ASEAN countries about competition from China, because we believe that this was good for the region, and if it's good for the region, it's good for Singapore. Likewise, we welcome China's recent proposals to upgrade the ASEAN-China Free Trade Agreement, establish an Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, and promote closer cooperation through the 21st Century Maritime Silk Road. We did all this because we felt that China's continued peaceful development would be beneficial to the region. Earlier this month, Singapore assumed the coordinatorship for ASEAN-China Dialogue Partnership. This is one of ASEAN's most substantive partnerships. We look forward to working with China and fellow countries, ASEAN countries, to expand and deepen this cooperation. However, in order to do this, we must better manage the territorial disputes between China and some ASEAN countries in the South China Sea. You would have all read about this in the newspapers. At the very minimum, we hope that all parties can fully implement the declaration of conduct that we have signed, and that we can swiftly conclude a legally binding code of conduct. So looking ahead, China and Singapore should continue to strengthen our friendship and cooperation at all levels. To commemorate the 25th anniversary of our diplomatic relations, our presidents have agreed to an exchange of state visits. President Tony Tan has just concluded his state visit. We look forward to welcoming President Xi Jinping later this year. To raise our relationship to a new level, we are now discussing the upgrading of our bilateral FTA with China. At the suggestion of top Chinese leaders, we are exploring a third government-level project in China's western region. So I've been doing a lot of COG, Journey to the West, lately. We hope to discuss, to be able to disclose more details about the progress of this project shortly. So today, Singapore and China share a unique, substantive, and forward-looking partnership. This is due to the tireless efforts of Singaporeans and Chinese across our societies. So as we celebrate the silver jubilee of our relations and head towards a golden jubilee, I look forward to working with my fellow Singaporeans, our Chinese friends, to build on our strong foundation and to raise our cooperation to an even higher plane for the benefit of our peoples. And when we gather here again for a Tembusu Forum during our Golden Jubilee, I hope to see some of you standing on this stage speaking about our special relationship with China. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Stanley Lo, for that eloquent and very substantive presentation. We will now hear the Chinese perspective. I had invited Ambassador Chen Xiaotong to be with us this evening, but unfortunately he's not able to come because he has to welcome an important delegation from China. Representing the Chinese embassy is the counselor, Mr. Zhai Xinfu, who is a very experienced Chinese diplomat and a scholar. He has served overseas in Samoa, in Bahamas, with the permanent mission of China to the UN in Vienna. And he had also spent a year as a visiting scholar at the Australian National University. It is therefore with very great pleasure that I invite Mr. Tsai to speak to us.
Professor Tomiko, Your Excellency Ambassador Stanley Lo, Mr. Go Sintek, editor of Lianhe Zaobao, and other dignitaries, distinguished guests, dear faculty members and students. It gives me great pleasure to join you at the Tembusu Forum on celebrating 25 years of diplomatic relations between China and Singapore. First of all, please allow me to extend on behalf of the Chinese Embassy and Ambassador Chen Xiaodong our sincere appreciation for the warm invitation and heartfelt congratulations on this forum. Just now, Professor Tommy Low recalled the process of the establishment of China-Singapore relations. And Ambassador Stanley recalled the exchanges and cooperation between China and Singapore during the past 25 years. Now, I will say something from my perspective on the China-Singapore relations. You know, actually, no one is more suitable than Professor Koh to chair today's forum, because, you know, he was and is a witness of the process of negotiations of Singapore-China relations. 2 weeks ago, Singapore observed its Golden Jubilee, and I had the honor to share with the Singaporeans their national pride and joy. It's the Singaporean people who, with the tenacious efforts, created the unique Singapore model and raised their motherland to one of the most developed countries in Asia and beyond. Today, I see so many young and vibrant students here with us, which reminds me of the famous remarks about young people by the founding leader of the Chinese Communist Party, that's Mao Zedong. I quote here, "The world is yours as well as ours, but in the last analysis, it is yours. You young people, full of vigor and vitality, are in the bloom of life, like the sun at 8 or 9 in the morning. Our hope is placed on you," unquote. So, I'm fully convinced that the next 50 years for Singapore will definitely be much more successful. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, the 25th anniversary of our diplomatic relations falls on October the 3rd. However, the friendly exchanges between our two peoples are much longer than 25 years, even older than the heritage Tembusu tree in the Botanic Garden. In 1877, it was in Singapore that the Qing Dynasty appointed China the first ever consular in history, and initiated a new chapter in China-Singapore friendly exchanges. Back to the late 1970s, leaders of the older generation, like Mr. Deng Xiaoping and Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, with their long-term and strategic vision, worked together and set up a framework guiding China-Singapore relations, which underpinned their fast and all-round growth in the decades that followed. After the establishment of diplomatic ties between China and Singapore in 1990, the relationship has kept growing from strength to strength and has always been at the forefront of China's overall external relations. It seems to me that today's China-Singapore relationship has the following striking features. First, frequent high-level visits have led the relationship to continuous growth. Mr. Lee Kuan Yew has visited China 33 times and met with Chinese leaders of all the 5 generations. This only happens between China and Singapore. Moreover, successive leaders of our two countries have all maintained close exchanges and met frequently on bilateral and multilateral occasions. Over the recent months, we already had a string of high-level visits. In early July, President Tony Tan paid a successful state visit to China. During this visit, President Xi Jinping emphasized that China and Singapore are close and special partners, while President Tan stressed that we need to bring our relationship to new levels. It is fair to say that the visits have chartered the course for our relations in the years to come. After President Tan's visit to China, as a special envoy of President Xi Jinping, the Vice President Li Yuanchao of China came to Singapore for its SG50 celebration. And China's Foreign Minister Wang Yi also visited Singapore in August. In about 2 weeks, China will hold the commemoration for the 70th anniversary of the victory of Chinese People's War of Resistance against Japanese aggression and the World Anti-Fascist War. Media call it the V-Day commemoration. The Singaporean government has appointed Mr. Wang Kai-sen as a special representative to attend the event. Mr. Wang was the DPM and foreign minister who inaugurated our diplomatic ties in 1990. That fully demonstrates the importance attached by the Singaporean side to the commemoration event. China and Singapore are all victims of World War II. And more importantly, we all contributed significantly to the final victory and endured tremendous sacrifice. Chinese people will by no means forget the history. I believe the Singaporeans will do the same. There is a book in Singapore titled Shao Nan Years, Zhao Nan Shidai, which gives a vivid recount on how we, people of China and Singapore, supported each other during the wartime. I wanted to point out here in particular is that during the most difficult times of the war, more than 3,000 volunteers from Southeast Asia went to China. Braving all dangers, they drove back and forth on the Burma Road and transported much needed materials into China. And many of them have made ultimate sacrifices for that. Thus, the commemoration is not just for victory of the Chinese People's War against Japanese aggression. It's also for remembering the indelible achievements we Asian people had made for world peace. It is not targeted at any other country, nor will it pass down the hatred. The Chinese people wanted to stand together with all the peace-loving peoples to remember the lessons of history, pay tribute to the heroes, cherish the peace, and open up a better future for mankind. Secondly, the economic cooperation keeps deepening and contributes to the integration of our interests. Just now, Ambassador Stanley Low mentioned some of that, but maybe because of the different means of calculation, some of the figures are different. Now I just give my figures. According to China's custom, China-Singapore trade volume has grown from $2.8 billion US in 1990 to $79.7 billion US in 2014, increased by over 28 times. In 2008, China-Singapore signed the very first bilateral FTA between China and East Asian countries. Currently, China is Singapore's largest trading partner, while Singapore is China's largest export market and third largest trading partner in ASEAN and the second largest labor market in the world. Amid the sluggish global economy, China's overall export and import declined in the first 5 months this year. However, its trade with Singapore grew by 4.4%, reaching $31.8 billion. That shows the resilience and great potential in our economic relations. In terms of investment, in 1990, Singapore's investment in China was only $50 million, but by the end of 2014, it has leapt to $74.7 billion, making Singapore China's largest investor as a country. At the same time, China's investment in Singapore is also increasing rapidly. In terms of finance, Singapore is now the second largest offshore renminbi, the Chinese currency, a clearing center in the world, second only to Hong Kong. In 2014, Chinese yuan and Singapore dollar started direct trading, which is a historical event. Now, five largest Chinese commercial banks have all opened their branches in Singapore. Third, China and Singapore have successful mechanisms to ensure that we can draw each other's strengths from common development. Over the past 2.5 decades, we have built comprehensive cooperation mechanisms in the spirit of mutual benefits and mutual complementarity. We now have 2 government-to-government projects, 3 mechanisms at the deputy prime minister level, and 7 cooperation platforms at the local government level. We also have the forum on leadership and a higher-level forum on social governance. All the mechanisms are producing fruitful outcomes. Among them, the 2 government-to-government projects, namely the Shudo Industrial Park and the Tianjin EcoCity, are the benchmarks of our cooperation. Building upon that achievement, we are actively discussing the 3rd government-to-government project. Fourth, the people-to-people exchanges are close and frequent and have been enhancing the foundation for the long-term growth of our relations. In 1990, only 70,000 Singaporeans and 30,000 Chinese visited each other's countries. But in 2014, the total number has reached 2.38 million. Every day, more than 6,000 people are shuttling between our 2 countries by plane. Since 1996, more than 30,000 Chinese officials and cadres have received trainings in Singapore. In 2014, there were 13,000 Chinese students in Singapore and about 5,000 Singaporean students in China. Every year, we have more than 200 cultural exchanges activities. Singapore is also one of the largest overseas performing markets to China. In Singapore's major cultural events, like the Singapore Cultural Festivals and the River Hongbao, one can always find distinctive Chinese features and enjoy traditional Chinese performances. China-Singapore relations is standing at a new start point and faces new opportunities to achieve even greater future. From now on, we must work even harder to open up new prospects for China-Singapore relationship. We can work together in the following areas. First, we can further enhance strategic communication and safeguard our practical cooperation with stronger political trust. Second, we can forge new drivers and inject new impetus to upgrade our relations. Third, we can explore new dimensions in cultural and people-to-people exchanges so as to mount an enduring engine for our relations. And fourth, we can seize new opportunity to raise China-ASEAN relations to new levels. Distinguished guests, dear students, I used to be a teacher of a high school. So today, facing so many students, to conclude my remarks here, I wish to say something special to the young students. The future of Singapore belongs to you. The future of China-Singapore relations belongs to you and relies on you. And we have every reason and every confidence in the future. I'm sure the next 25 years will definitely be more fascinating and fruitful. Thank you all.
I thank Mr. Tai for his very good presentation. He has to leave us soon to receive a visiting delegation from China, and his colleague, Mr. Yuan Yuan, will take his place during the Q&A session. We wanted a third speaker to present a perspective from the people's point of view, and we are very fortunate this evening to have with us the esteemed editor, Lien Zhao Bao, Mr. Goh Sin Teck. Sin Teck, please come and share with us a people's point of view.
Prof. Koh, Ambassador Low, Councillor Chai, fellow faculty members and students. When I was preparing for this PowerPoint presentation last week, I really regretted to agreeing to come to this forum. The main reason was because I told myself, after two such a distinguished and senior diplomats, what more can I add to that? So I was very tempted last week to then call Professor Koh and say, you know, the election is coming, my newsroom is very busy, and could you excuse me? But then I thought, then Professor will never then forgive me. And worse still, he may then be very angry and never again to agree to be interviewed by my colleagues from Lien Zhao Bao. Then that will not only be the loss of Lien Zhao Bao, but more importantly, the loss of the readers of Lien Zhao Bao. So here I am. So I decided that I best do something that I'm more familiar with, that is to tell story. So tonight I'm going to just share with you some of my personal experience, my personal encounter, and my observation. 2 weeks ago, or in fact, roughly 2 weeks ago, my distant cousin from China visited us in Singapore because my elderly aunt wasn't very well. So when I met her, I then asked her, you know, did you also take this opportunity to, you know, because normally when China visitors come, they normally will not only cover Singapore, they will also cover Malaysia and Thailand. So I asked her whether you take this opportunity to also go to Malaysia and Thailand, and how many days are you spending in Singapore and so on, you know. Then she told me, oh, no. I'm only come here for the sole purpose of visiting Sanku, she called my aunt as Sanku, just the sole purpose of visiting my third aunt. And she said, the rest of it, she will come for another time. And she said to me that, you know, nowadays air ticket is so cheap. And then she also told me that she was in fact just back from a trip from France. And it reminded me that about 15 years ago, things has really changed. At that time, when my cousin came to Singapore, I remembered my aunt was trying to collect old clothes, those if I may say very, you know, unwanted clothes, those clothes that are a bit too old-fashioned, and my aunts are collecting them. And the reason why is because so that we can pack together and then let my cousin bring all this back to China. If we were to do it this time round, I think my cousin may get offended because of that. Her story or her life, I think, reflects very well how China has changed. And because of that, I think Singapore-China relationship has also developed quite tremendously. I remember my first trip to China. That was 22 years ago, in 1993. A very lasting impression that I got from that trip was this. When I do the PowerPoint presentation, I tried to Google, and actually I found it. Have you all heard of Wai Hui Chuan? I think those many of you here may not have heard of it, Wai Hui Chuan. At that time, when I visited China in 1993, I can't change renminbi in Singapore because renminbi then was a controlled currency. You are not allowed, at least theoretically, you are not allowed to bring the renminbi outside of China. It is a controlled currency. It is supposed to be only circulated in China. And then for the tourists, you have to exchange the Wai Hui Chuan. This is how it looks like. Yeah. It is only until, if I'm not wrong, 1995 that the Wai Hui Chuan was stopped. And then renminbi become the currency there. So this is how it looks like. And at the back of it, you have some English words. You can read for yourself. So the Wai Hui Chuan in English is called Foreign Exchange Certificate. And the exchange rate is quite different. So there's a black market exchange rate in China. When you go into China, then for one Singapore dollar, I can't remember how much was it, but anyway, it is different. So on, if you go to a restaurant who serves foreigners, then on the menu, you can see two listings. One is renminbi, and the other one is in Wai Hui Chuan. So we are all discriminated as a foreigner because we pay much more expensive than the locals. Firstly, because the exchange rate is different, and then secondly, the price is also different. It was also different. Anyway, that was then, 22 years ago. Then 22 years ago, when we thought of going to China, I think quite logical, the images of China is something like this. That one come later. Then I also remembered those things that I bought back from China. It's called Fu Ling Bing. It is kind of a biscuit, and then the filling is from Chinese herbs, if I'm not wrong. And that Chinese herb is said to be good for your liver and your kidney. The packaging that you see now is the new packaging. I can't find the old one. So that one, when we bought it back then, it was kind of a novelty. I personally don't really like it, but it's kind of novelty, so everyone will try it. In fact, nowadays, if I were to buy this and then bring back to my newsroom, I think nobody will ever touch it already. Yeah, this is what I meant just now. At that time, when we think of the images of China, this is what will come in mind, right? It is either very historical, or some beautiful scenery. I mean, all these pictures all these places are still there. But then, in fact, in 22 years, China has changed dramatically. This is not Singapore, definitely. This is the Lijiao Chow of Shanghai. You can see how many rounds, and it is in Shanghai. When I Google it, this is what I found. This is the biggest, what should I call that? 写字楼, or 办公楼, office building. The biggest office building using solar panel. Those things on top, I think they are solar panel. I have not been to there, this place, but it's just how impressive this building is. Another one. If you think that our what we call that MBS, Marina Bay Sands, is very impressive, look at this. This is what you call the Shenzhen Huzhou. I need to put on. Can you read it for me? The Sheraton Huzhou Hot Spring Resort. 22 years ago, I don't have to put on this. And this is the longest bridge over water in the world. it is almost 42 km. If I were the Chinese, I would build it exactly as the distance of a marathon. Then I can call it a marathon bridge. It is almost 42, so only maybe another 1 kilometer. In fact, I have something to show you. There's a hyperlink. Let me see whether... Just want to show you how impressive this is. You're controlling for me? Just imagine every year they hold a marathon there. From this end to the other end. Okay, I think, yeah, thanks. So you can help me to go back to, okay, thank you. This is the night view. So China has changed very much. Then I had some Chinese visitor who came to Singapore a few months ago. So I brought them to this place called No Signboard Seafood. Have you all heard of this place? You have been, huh? So I think it is quite famous in Singapore. But anyway, have you heard of that? Okay, it's quite famous. So I brought my Chinese visitors there. And after the dinner, they told me, hey, Xingti, they call me Xingti. Thank you for bringing me here. This restaurant is very famous in China. Then I was very amazed. How did you know that this No Signboard is very famous in China? And they told me that, there's this Tianping Wang. Have you heard of this Tianping Wang? It is a Chinese equivalent of like Hungry Go Where type of app or website. And their Tianping Wang is supposed to serve only the Chinese for the Chinese cities. But there's also one that is dedicated to Singapore. And on that Singapore sub-website, there's mention about this No Signboard Seafood. It reflects how intimate the two countries are. Well, we don't go to China only for food, and they don't come here only for food. We have other activities. This is what I found out. For the past 15 years, NYC has sent more than 6,000 youth to China for exchange program. This photo, I think, is Operation Dujiangyan, the Sichuan earthquake. After the Sichuan earthquake, I think the Singapore Poly students went there to visit some of the primary school students. Of course, the Singapore companies also play their part. This is CapitaLand, also went to, I think, Dujiangyan or Sichuan, also doing their CSR there. And this is the NTU, you can read that, right? The NTU convocation in China. Not Singapore, you know, in China, and see how many graduates they have. And in fact, according to their, sorry that I have to mention NTU in NUS. I belong to both families. I was from NUS, but I also sit on the board of the trustees of NTU. According to NTU's statistics, there were more than 15,000 Chinese officials attended courses organized by NTU alone. And then more than 50,000 had come to Singapore for some form of training. Some are longer, some are shorter. If I show you these two pictures 20 years ago, many Singaporeans will find them, will not be familiar with all this food. But this can be found now in Singapore. And again, it reflects not only the how our food has changed, but it reflects how, because of the intimate relationship, the frequent interaction, that Singapore and China both have changed so much. I think the right The one on your right is called the Liangfen. Am I correct? No, not the Liangfen. Huh? Liangfen. And then the other one, I think, is the Pai Gu Mian or something. This one is not somewhere in China, but in New Chesui, Chinatown. Chinatown used to be famous for local hawker fare, but now you will find a lot of this mala tang and things like that, which again is alien to Singapore 20 years ago. And why? Because there are now so many visitors from Singapore, from China, that there's a demand for it. And also, of course, we should also include the immigrants. And they are not only can be found in places like, you know, Chinatown, in the town, but they also go into our heartland. This is the Xi'an Delights, and it is a Bedok branch going into our heartland. Of course, the exchange is not one-way street. So we also have some, we also go into China market. This is bread talk, not in Singapore, but in China. Why? Because if you see the Chinese word, it is 面包 xingyu, not 面包物语. In Singapore, it's called 面包物语, but in China, it is called 面包 xingyu. So we also have some influence there as well. And people are also quite used to our floss bread. Is it called floss bread? Yeah. And this is yakun. This can be found in China, in Suzhou, in Zhujiang, and in Shanghai as well. I want to show you this because this illustrates. The trade figures and everything give us some perspective, but this gives us another perspective that how life has changed since we have a diplomatic relationship with China for the two countries. And this, again, this is what we call the chiffon cake. This is Bengawan Solo. Only until recently, then I found that, okay, this one is also quite popular in China. When my Chinese visitors come to Singapore and specifically ask me to bring them to Bengawan Solo so that they can buy this back to China, then they told me, you know, this thing can be found in Taobao Wang. You know Taobao Wang, right? So I actually went to search and I found this. In China, this chiffon cake is called the Lü Dan Gao, the green cake. And it's so much more expensive. So next time when you go to China, you can bring a few boxes there. A few quick bucks. So China has changed. It has developed tremendously. It has become more confidence. And because of that, it wants to have a fair share of its voice in the world. When I was much younger, I attended one of this exchange program organized by U.S. Embassy. And U.S. Embassy, for many, many years, at least they will have four exchange programs every year, so it's once every quarter, to gather journalists, especially from the developed countries. I do not know why Singapore is part of that, but never mind. Anyway, they will then invite all the journalists to the U.S., so that they can sell them their ideas, their ideology, and everything, so that they can understand U.S. better. And for the past few years, China has been doing that as well. And these are just some of the examples. And in fact, nowadays, there were so many invitations from China, either official invitation or some of them are from maybe Xinhua or maybe from Renminbi Ripao. There were so many of these invitations that many a times I have to turn them down because I just couldn't have enough reporters to send to all this program. So you can see China is changing. China is also wanting to show its soft power to the world. This comic used to describe this saying that when US sneezes, the world catch a cold. This is the old saying. Lien He Zao Pao just published another cartoon, which is quite similar. For those of you who cannot read, the big fat guy is, it carries a bag and says, China economy. He's the one who sneezed. And everyone around him all were afraid that they will also catch a cold. This illustrates the status of China now. If China were to change, has changed over the past 25 years, has changed so much, it can only be expected that the relationship between the two countries will also have to develop and have to take a different shape. That is country to country. And I'm sure between people and people, I think sometimes we will also have to adjust. But I'm also quite sure that the friendship between the two countries, people to people, not only country to country, but people to people friendship, will last not only for the next 25 years, but more years to come. Thank you.
I'd now like to call our guests to the podium and call our students, particularly, to the microphones at either end of the room, where you'll be allowed to address your questions to any member of the audience. Professor Ko will moderate. And please, when you ask a question, please first introduce yourself by your college or by the department. And please, also, because there's probably quite a few questions, if I can limit students to one question. Thank you.
Yes, please. Yes. We'll begin with these two students, and then we'll come to you. So let's take two questions at a time. Please go ahead.
All right. Good evening. My name is Samuel. I'm a fourth-year student in Tembusu College. I'm a political science economics double major. And I have one question to ask all members of the panel. How do you think that the most recent wave of immigration between China to Singapore might shape future relations between the two countries? Thank you very much.
Thank you. So to repeat, the question is, how does the immigration of Chinese to Singapore affect our bilateral relations? The second question.
Good evening, Prof. Koh and all panelists. My name is Ingma. I'm a fourth-year history major, Tembusu alumni. My question is on the role of Singapore in China's Yitai-Yilu policy, because when I was on exchange last year in Nanjing University, and what I noticed was that there was an exhibition at Suzhou Industrial Park, and what was conspicuously missing, even though it was in Suzhou Industrial Park, was actually the role of Singapore on this China's a One Belt, One Road policy. So other ports that were mentioned include Port Alexandria in Egypt, as well as some ports in Indonesia and Sri Lanka, but Singapore was conspicuously missing, even though the Suzhou Industrial Park was actually a brainchild of Deng Xiaoping and Mr. Lee Kuan Yew.
Okay, thank you.
So
okay.
What is the role of Singapore in
okay.
One Belt,
I don't know whether all the other students know what One Belt, One Road means. Maybe I should just explain that President Xi Jinping has made several very important proposals, one of which has already materialized, and this is the proposal to establish an Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, AIIB. That has come to pass. He also suggested reviving the ancient overland Silk Road, which connected China through Central Asia to West Asia and Europe. And the Chinese refer that as a belt. He's also proposed reviving the ancient maritime Silk Road, which connected China, Northeast Asia, Southeast Asia, South Asia, all the way through to the Middle East and to Europe. So these are two very important proposals made by President Xi Jinping. They're still on the table for discussion. And I think the question is, what is Singapore's respond to these two proposals? What role the Singapore envisage for itself? I think Ambassador Stanley Lai would be the best person to answer that question. So let me just pause and ask the panel whether any of them would like to answer the two questions. One, the impact of immigration from China to Singapore on our bilateral relations. And second question, Singapore's role in the One Belt and One Road. Maybe we should have one more question for Yuan Yuan. We need a question for our Chinese colleague. Do you have a question for our Chinese colleague?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
Okay, good evening. My name is Go Yang. I'm a year two psychology major for Tembusu College. And the question I'm going to ask is basically, in light of China's recent devaluation of their currency, especially that now that Singapore has hit a 1.3% low of all time in the past 5 years, what exactly would be the stance that both China as well as Singapore should adopt in order to either fix this or progress onwards from this?
Sorry, repeat the question again.
So basically...
The recent devaluation of RMB, is that?
Yes, correct. Yeah. So what I would like to ask is how China and Singapore should proceed from this point onwards with regard to this, since this could increase China's exports by a huge amount.
Okay. All right. So that's an assumption, right? I mean, you're assuming that the devaluation of the renminbi will lead to greater Chinese export competitiveness and therefore more exports from China to Singapore. Okay.
Yes.
Three good questions. Let me go around. Maybe I start with Stanley. Stanley, maybe you're going to go first.
Always take instructions from the guru. So I'll make some brief remarks on all three questions. First, on immigration. I observe two important trends in immigration patterns between Singapore and China. The one that we notice more is Chinese immigrants coming to Singapore. But actually, this is not new. We have been an immigrant society for as long as there's Singapore, modern Singapore, right? We won't be here if Singapore did not welcome immigrants. So I'm a third generation Chinese, ethnic Chinese. When I was young, my elders, my shushu and ayi all asked me, 你是不是中国人? And I used to think, no, 我是新加坡人, I'm Singaporean. But you know, the older generation, they always ask like that. And they say, are you from Tangshan? You know. But over the years, we say, well, I'm Singaporean and 我是华人. You know, so all of you say that. So that's shaped and that's changed. So Singapore, I think fundamentally, we are a very welcoming immigrant society. We welcome immigrants because this is how we were built. And in fact, if you look at our population, even today, resident population is 5.3 million, but actually the actual number of Singaporeans is only about 3.8. So if you go out in the street, out of every four persons you see, one will be someone who's not born in Singapore. So that's a high percentage. So that's the first point I want to make. And because most of us are not having enough babies, I'm afraid, you know, we will have to have some immigration in some form. Otherwise, we are already so small and we will become smaller over time. But this is election season, so I don't want to cause trouble for our political masters. The reality is we have to adjust to the political situation, and so the government has made some adjustments to our immigration policy to slow down the growth. But slowing down the growth does not mean no growth. There is still growth. That means there's still a very gradual increase, but we have slowed it down. And to let the infrastructure catch up. And the infrastructure has been catching up. All right? So I won't elaborate too much on that. I'll let the candidates do so. But the other trend in our immigration that I want to talk about is this. Our forefathers came to look for a better living. And actually, when they came, they never expected to stay in Singapore. Many left their families in China and hoped to go back to China to retire when they had made some money. Today, we are seeing a reverse immigration. Many of you, after you graduate, will be working in China. And you will be going there to earn a better living. But you will not give up your red passport.
Any idea how many Singaporeans working in China?
Well, those with residency permits is about 20,000. But many go and work and you don't need a residency permit. You know, you can work and you can come back and you travel often. So it is quite a large number. I meet lots of them. So this is a reverse immigration. You will go, you will keep your red passport, and after you earn a better living, at some point you want to come back to Singapore to retire. So that's the reverse immigration. So it's very interesting. The role of Singapore in One Belt, One Road, I will just say this. What the Chinese leaders have proposed is a new Silk Road economic belt, new, the emphasis is new, and a 21st century maritime Silk Road. So we are not talking about the traditional Silk Road carried by camels or eunuchs in a boat. We are talking about a modern Silk Road. So what's the difference? Well, the modern Silk Road means maybe things can fly. People can fly. Aviation. In the old days, there was no aviation. In the modern Silk Road, we are not just connecting goods and people. We can connect money, financial connectivity. We can connect information. And business is transacted over the internet. So in the concept of modern Silk Road, 21st century Silk Road, there's modern connectivity. We're talking about the flow of money, ideas, people, information. Singapore has a role to play. We talked about it just now, renminbi internationalization, right? So maybe we can facilitate the trade in renminbi. More of this movement of investments and goods and all that can be conducted in renminbi. Singapore has a role. We are a major air hub. Is there something that we can do? When people invest in our region very often, well, we cannot put all the factories in Singapore because, you know, land is scarce and we cannot take in too many foreign workers. So what happens? But a lot of people put their operational headquarters in Singapore, or they put their holdings company in Singapore. And these are the good paying jobs. These are the jobs that you guys want to do, right? So I think there is a role for Singapore, and this is the role we can play. Lastly, a short answer to the third question on what do we do with the currencies. My own view is do nothing. Let the market decide.
And on the so-called devaluation of the renminbi recently, one should put it in context. In the last few years, the renminbi had actually appreciated in value by about 30%. And the recent devaluation is actually a very small devaluation. And you must also view it in the larger context, which is that in recent years and even decades, countries like the United States, Japan, Europe have all been engaging in what the economists call quantitative easing, which is in effect a gradual devaluation of their respective national currencies. Sintek, thank you for your very interesting presentation, a ground level view of the dramatic changes that have taken place in China and in the relation between our two countries. And your point is absolutely correct that the two countries have changed and the relationship between us must also change. I think that's your basic point, I think. Huh? Would you like to answer any of the three questions?
I'm not in a position to answer questions on devaluation and you know, even the immigration policy, how would it affect Singapore-China relationship with all the diplomats here, I better, you know. But I'll just touch on the personal perspective of it. That is, again, you look back at my PowerPoint presentation just now. 20 years ago, we don't have all this food from Sichuan, from the Tongbei. We were although we were a Chinese immigrant society, we were basically more from the southern China. But the new immigrant brought in not only the food, which we don't have before that, but they brought in new perspective, and it enriches our culture. So it really depends on how you see it, whether it will dilute our sense of belonging and our Singaporeanness, or it further enriches our diversity. It really depends on your own perspective then.
Yuan Yuan, would you like to comment on any of the questions?
Thank you. First, please allow me to express my sorry for the absence of my ambassador and counselor. I'm humbled to be present here, compared with the professor and a distinguished ambassador of Singapore to China, and also editor-in-chief, Mr. Shindi. But I'm also proud that I'm the, on behalf of the post 80 in Chinese, Ba Ling Ho. And this year marks the 10th anniversary of my graduation from Foreign Affairs College. So I'm very, very happy to meet with so many vibrant students here in the Tembusu College. And I will introduce myself a little bit about my past working experience, which I think is beneficial to answer the third question about the RMB, because I was working in the International Department of Foreign Ministry for about 5 years and in charge of specifically about the IMF. And at that time, you know, the most thorny issue between China and the US is the RMB exchange rate. Yeah. And there is kind of Article 4 consultation conducted by IMF and with sovereign countries about the macroeconomic policy. And at that time, we will get a very headache when we're talking about RMB. And as mentioned by Professor Cole, that RMB has been appreciated for about 30% in the past 10 years. So the question of that student lies on the most important thing is that how you look at the current value of RMB, devalued or overestimated? I think there is a recently released statistic by Peterson Institute of International Economics. In the first half of this year, the actual value of RMB has been overestimated about 1%. Mm-hmm. So that means there is still room for devaluation. But I'm not saying that RMB will continue to devalue, but that will decide it, as Ambassador Law mentioned, decided by the market. Mm-hmm. So the suggestion for the Singaporean economy, there are two aspects. First aspect for the trade, I think you don't have too much to worry about the Sino-Singapore trade, because we are at different levels of development and we have different labor, a division of labor in the international trade system, and we are not a competitor. To some extent, we have very good complementary economic structure. And we have advancing with times with every areas like the Suzhou Industrial Park, the Tianjin Eco City, and also the third G2G project. We have every reason to upgrade a very large room to upgrade our relations and our economic relations. For the second perspective is that when you compare with exchange rate, you will find that it will make you much more cheaper for you to invest in China. So that is another advantage for you to invest in China, because you get a much more stronger Singapore dollar, and you will find that the asset in China will be much more cheaper. So I think it is an opportunity for the Singaporean to invest in China, to take the opportunity to make you much more stronger. And finally, I would add to the first question about immigration, because I'm the new immigration, only 3 months from China now to Singapore. I have very, very wonderful experiences in the past 3 months. I think the Chinese migrant, like me, but not, I'm not a real migrant, I'm a diplomat, they will join the life in Singapore and will make you much more diversity as you did in the past 50 years. Thank you.
I thank Yuan Yuan for a very good answer. I forgot to mention something. The student who asked a question about the 21st century maritime Silk Route, I would just mention that I had helped the Singapore Business Federation to organize a regional forum on the 21st century maritime Silk Route. And I had brought from Beijing the chairman of the Foreign Affairs Committee of the National People's Congress, Madam Fu Ying, to deliver a keynote address. And I had made a speech on behalf of Singapore at the forum. My speech is available in the college website if you're interested. Yeah. So let's take 3 more questions. Could I? Yes, please.
Hello, good evening. I'm Nurmi Yati. I'm a freshman from Tembusu College. Okay, so essentially, right, I'm quite interested to know the opinions of both China and Singapore with regards to this issue. Would you say that Singapore actually plays a key role in balancing the geopolitical balance between the USA and China? Thank you.
Well, that's a very profound question. Where are you from, by the way? Are you Singaporean?
Yes, I'm Singaporean.
Okay, thank you. That is a very important question. I think we will ask Stanley and Yuan Yuan to answer that. But let's take two more questions. Another lady here.
Hello, my name is Bing Fei. I'm from business, year 3 student. So my question is, as most people believe that the investment projects like Suzhou Industrial Park and Guangzhou Knowledge City is a big success, some Chinese media actually reported that the Singapore government actually suffered some financial loss, partly because the local government has set a replica just next to the industrial park. So I wonder, what's the Singapore perspective response to this kind of incident? And do you think that the such government collaborated investment project is sustainable compared to private-led investment projects?
Thank you. Yes. We'll take a third question. Yes.
Hello, I'm Lin Kang, and I'm a year two student from the Faculty of Arts and Social Sciences from Tembusu College also. And so with the elections looming, I think I'd like to ask a pertinent question, which is, with Singapore's changing political landscape and the possibility of a two-party system replacing the current one-party system, how might our relations with China be different in 25 years or 50 years to come? Because I think very often we see international relations only as statistics or announcements of treaties on a newspaper, but very often international relations can also be about personal relations. Thank you. Okay.
Thank you. So we have three good questions. The first question is, how does Singapore position itself in between the intense competition for influence between China and the United States? The second question is more of a comment, right? Whether Singapore has suffered losses or benefited from these large government-to-government projects like Suzhou and Tianjin and the private sector-led government-supported project in Guangzhou. And then, well, I think we'll take three questions at a time. Maybe we go in reverse order. Yeah, well, let's go in the reverse order. Let's start with Yuan Yuan.
Okay, it is a really tough question for the geopolitical balance. As you mentioned, Singapore may be played between China and the U.S. And I think you are very lucky because you are studying in your college headed by Professor Cole, and he's a really professor and expert in this area because he was posted to Washington and also twice as the U.N. representative. So. From my personal...
You're trying to make me answer the question, is it? Okay. No, you answer the question.
From my personal view, I think that Singapore is quite unique in terms of the relations between China and U.S. And my colleagues, Mr. Yang Chen, have accompanied my ambassador to call the U.S. ambassador here in Singapore that... to some extent, we believe that maybe for Singapore, the Sino-US relations is even much more important than the bilateral relations between Singapore and the US and Singapore and China. Because as Prime Minister Lee Hsien Loong mentioned in the Future China Forum, which is presided by Cindy, that Singapore never want to take side between the two countries. We fully understand that, and we never view Singapore as the mini China, as mentioned by Ambassador Noel. And we are equal country. We treat each other equally. And we want Singapore to be the bridge between China and the US. The bridge is not in terms of international relations, but in terms of culture and our relations, because you know that Singapore is always advocating for the communication between West and East. And also a very renowned Singapore scholar, Mr. Kishore Mohabani, has wrote the book Convergence. And that is the best philosophy I like personally in the current world arena, because we need such kind of communication and convergence between great powers. And we are seek a new kind of big country relations between China and US. We want to avoid the so-called conflict between big powers. So that is our view, and we want Singapore, especially young Singaporeans, to play the unique role to bridge the China and the US, bridge West and East, to make the next 25 years much more better than now. Thank you.
Thank you, Yuan Yuan. Sintek?
Prof, I will pass. I will just report on what they have said.
But you had the honor of moderating the dialogue with the Prime Minister at the Future China Forum.
Right. Yeah? Yes. I'm more comfortable asking questions than taking questions. No, really, yeah. I'll leave it to the okay. two.
The next round, you have to answer the question. Stanley, any of the three questions?
I knew I should have eaten more at dinner just now. Because it's very hard work. You know?
I'm a very good student, I think. They ask good questions.
Let me take the three questions in reverse order. First, party politics in Singapore and how that may affect the bilateral relationship. Well, first of all, I'm a civil servant, so I'm not allowed to comment on whether Singapore is headed towards a one-party system or two-party system. Anyway, as part of the civil service, it doesn't matter to me. Because my recommendation to my political masters will be the same, which is we will make friends with every foreign country who wants to make friends with us. And this is a relationship between countries and between peoples, not with parties. So as long, in any country, whoever comes to power, as long as they are willing to cooperate with us for mutual benefit, then we will cooperate and we will make friends. So, and I'm sure that is also the philosophy of the Chinese leadership. You asked a good question about the Suzhou Industrial Park. Were there problems? Were there challenges in the early phases? Yes, there were. In fact, the only way to face no challenge and no difficulty is to do nothing. If you do nothing and have no projects and no investments, I assure you it'll be very peaceful. But it means that we will also all have no jobs. So, the issue is not whether we will face difficulties. The answer is we will always face difficulties in whatever we do with whichever country. The question is, how do we overcome them? Do we emerge stronger after this, after overcoming the difficulties? And what do we learn from this? You remember that when I talked about Suzhou Industrial Park, you know, I mentioned that it was at the early phase of China's opening up. You know, so we were, it's like dating, you know, getting to know each other. So you have to date for a few times, and sometimes there may be some disagreements here and there. And then you say, I thought you were dating me. How come you're going out with that girl also? Cannot lah, right? So, you know, that's what we did. You know, we went to the parents, and they say, 你女儿跟我交往, 怎么又跟她交往? How can your daughter go out with me and go out with the other chap? So they say, okay, cannot. And because at the political leadership level, we have strong mutual trust. Mr. Lee Kuan Yew at that time with Mr. Jiang Zemin, I think President Jiang knew that Singapore was doing this to be helpful to China. So they could talk frankly, we had a problem, let's face it squarely, let's overcome it. So President Jiang was also very supportive. What did he do? So indeed there was another industrial park next to Suzhou, and there was, well, I must say, the reality is, you know, whatever we can do, our Chinese friends can quickly follow up and do better. So what did President Jiang did? He plucked the leader from this mirror image industrial park and put him in Suzhou and say, you are in charge of Suzhou now. So in China, there's a common phrase, they said, you know, Yong, this doesn't sound very nice. Think with your bottom. Basically, where you sit determines how your brain works. So since he has now been moved to Suzhou, his responsibility is Suzhou, and he will want to make Suzhou successful. And I think that's why, you know, after we overcame the problem, Suzhou became very successful. One of the issues then was that when we first started investing in Suzhou, you know, this is a Singaporean mindset also. We always like to be the majority shareholder. So because of that, I think there were feelings that maybe this is Singapore's park. So one of the things we did, we will remain to be committed to the park, but we reduce our shareholding. We're still a major shareholder, but we gave the majority shareholding to the Chinese. So it's your park. And actually, whichever project we do, it's always China's park, because it's in China, right? The park can never come to Singapore, so it's always China's park. If it's a success, it reflects well on China. It reflects well on us too, but more for China. So I think it was a positive experience through working together in the Suzhou Industrial Park and subsequent projects. We made a lot of friends in China. I think it's overall a positive experience for our companies, because everywhere I go, every province, every governor and party secretary will always ask me for a Suzhou Industrial Park in their province. And I always say, no, there's only one Suzhou. Otherwise, we will build so many. Since China has already acquired the knowledge to do this, there is no need for Singapore to do the same. And in fact, Suzhou Industrial Park is now playing the role of replicating itself in different parts of China. Finally, the last question on US-Sino relations. In the scale, in the balance between US and China, the little red dot is very small. Whether you put the dot here or you put the dot there, it's not really going to tip the balance. So we must understand, you know, truly what's our place in the world. But we do have an interest. What is our interest? Our interest is that we wish that the two biggest powers of the world today will get along and do well. Because when the US and China get along, and we are able then to be friends with both, that means Singapore will have the most space to grow and develop ourselves. So we want to do our part where we can to help and to facilitate this. But we mustn't over-glorify our role and think that we're so influential and we can do this and we can do that. But we want to contribute to it and we facilitate this. So what can we do? It's not about language, but language is one of the issues, but culture. We are a society that operates in a Western mindset, rule of law, you know, we use English. But at the same time, we are an Asian society, Oriental to some extent. So at home, you know, we understand Chinese culture. We know that Chinese culture can be quite subtle. Our children and ourselves, most of us come from a bilingual system. So we were independent in 1965. From 1966, we had a bilingual system. So those of us who are ethnically Chinese, we learn English and we learn Mandarin. So we're able to be a bridge and communicate between the two. I want to say a few more words about our bilingual policy, which you may not notice, but you know, what we all recognize is Mandarin in Singapore is called the mother tongue, Mu Yu. Actually, our mothers don't speak Mandarin. Why? Because our ancestors are from Fujian, Guangdong, Hainan. They speak Hokkien, Cantonese, Hainanese, Teochew, Fuzhou. Very few people from the north who speak Putonghua. This was a political decision by Mr. Lee Kuan Yew. He wanted a common language for the Chinese to communicate, but also a language that will enable us to communicate and do business with China. So he picked Putonghua. You know, at the time when we started this, we had
more dealings with Hong Kong, Hong Kong, and Taiwan. And we learned simplified script, 简体字. You know, outside mainland China, nobody uses the 简体字 those days, and we did not have diplomatic relations with China. Taiwan, Hong Kong, even the Chinese in Malaysia, Indonesia, they all use the complex script, 繁体字. So Mr. Lee Kuan Yew saw that 30 years down the road, China is going to open up and it's going to become a big opportunity. And he wanted us to be able to communicate with the Chinese and to be able to read their newspapers. So he made us learn 简体字 and 普通话. So today we can use it. Now every country in the world is rushing to learn, but they will benefit 20 years later. So this is called foresight and vision. Thank you.
Thank you, Stanley. I want to make a brief comment on two of the questions. Singapore's policy towards China has the support not just of the People's Action Party, but I think of all the major political parties in Singapore. I think the leaders of the Workers' Party and SDP fundamentally do not disagree about our policy towards China. So I don't see that our China policy will change if the democracy in Singapore evolves and changes. On US-China relations, I must say, having spent a lot of time living in America and having worked with China, I think there's a huge deficit of trust between these two great countries. And I think ASEAN is playing an important role in helping to reduce that deficit of trust, to bring China and the United States to sit around the same table in a cooperative framework and to learn to work with one another, not against each other. And I think the reason why we brought the United States into the East Asia Summit is exactly for this purpose. And we are also trying to through economic liberalization and integration, bring about greater cooperation between the United States and Asia through TPP, and also between China and the rest of Asia to RCEP. In fact, our view, and I think Prime Minister Lee Hsien Loong has said this, is that we would like to see the United States eventually become a member of AIIB, and we would like to see China become a member of TPP. So ASEAN's agenda is that we want peace and cooperation to prevail between China and the United States. We don't want conflict or war between them. And in a very small way, we try to contribute to this. We are almost 9 o'clock, so maybe I will bring this to a close by asking each member of the panel, beginning, I think, with Sintek, since you answered the fewest question, whether you have some parting remarks to share with the student on the important relationship between China and Singapore.
I want to echo what Councillor has said just now, that in fact, if you are talking about the next 25 years or next 50 years of Singapore-China relationship, I think don't just ask questions, don't just put your questions to the political leaders and to the diplomats. You have to take ownership and you have to try to shape it. If you are not in the position to influence the policy, then at the people-to-people level, you can also play a part. How you welcome the newcomers into Singapore, how you treat them, and how you present yourself when you are overseas and things like that. I think every one of us here has a role to play and not just waiting for someone to solve that problem.
Thank you. That's a very, very good message for the student, that good relations between China and Singapore do not just depend on the two governments, but also depend on the people. And you can make a contribution to that process. Yuan Yuan, do you have some? You are the youngest member of the panel.
and you're closest in age to the student. So share some wise words with them.
I try. I only want to add is that last week, our ambassador Chen Xiaodong hosted a reception for the new freshman from Singapore, which were awarded by the Chinese government scholarship. And they will study in China, in Peking University, Fudan University, which is, to some extent, can be compared with your university. So I think for China, it is a so big country. The best method for you to learn China or to work, maybe work for the next 25 years Sino-Singapore relations, the best way for you is to go to China, to have a look at China. As Cindy has brought you so many pictures, so many vibrant pictures, and some places I haven't been to. So I hope you can go and to visit China, every place, including my hometown, Sichuan, and to find not more than pandas. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Yuan Yuan. Stanley, the last word is yours. Share with us some wise words for the student.
Well, I fully agree with Yuan Yuan and Cindy. I'd like to make just two simple points. First, as what Sintik said, people-to-people relations lay the foundation for the relationship between our two countries. When I first went to China, I visited Sichuan. The governor highly recommended that I go to Wenchuan, where there was a massive earthquake in 2008. So I took his advice, I changed my itinerary, I went. Of course, you know, it's now rebuilt. But what fascinated me was that when I went there, I had a very good reception. The people of Wenchuan were very warm, and they told me, you know, when we had the earthquake, Singapore was the third largest foreign donor, and we donated over 40 million Singapore dollars, people, government, businesses. This was also a record for Singapore in terms of outward donation for any foreign disaster. So I asked him, the locals, I said, who was the largest donor? They say, oh, Saudi Arabia. I said, big oil country. I said, who's number two? He said, United Arab Emirates. I said, small oil country. We are small and we have no oil. So I came back and I thought long and hard. I said, why did we do this? Because there are very strong people-to-people sentiments. So when we heard that, our friends in China have suffered a major disaster, people donated very kindly, generously. This year is the 25th anniversary of our relations. So sometime last year, I gathered our chambers, Singapore chambers in China, and I said, let's discuss what do we do to celebrate. We talk about getting Sun Yanzi to sing a song, and we talk about showing, you know, our boys to men. And then in the end, we said, no, let's do something meaningful. So last year, there was another earthquake in Yunnan, Ludian County. It's a minority region in Yunnan, mountainous region, very difficult for the kids to go to school. Do you know that some of them have to walk 2 hours to school, and after school walk 2 hours home through mountainous roads? So we got in touch with the locals, with the relevant authorities. We said, what do you need? And they said, we need hostels near the school so that the kids can stay in the hostels and then only go home once a week. So we got the whole Singapore community together, and we managed to raise 3.7 million RMB. And we are already in the process of building 3 hostels in 3 primary schools in Yunnan, in Ludian County. It's actually a very difficult year to raise money, I must tell you, really, honestly. Why? Because it's SG50. And because this is SG50, many countries recognize us this year, so there are many, many anniversaries. But yet, when the Singapore companies and the businesses heard, China, 25th anniversary, they donated very generously. Why? Because it came from the heart. So that is the evidence of this strong people-to-people relations. What's my parting advice to all of you? For the bulk of your adult career when you graduate, for the next 10, 20 years, the emergence of China
will be the greatest change to the global order. Right? This will be the biggest change. It will change all our lives and the lives of your children. So we have to be prepared for it. It's a major opportunity, but also a major adjustment process for everybody. So the more you are able to understand this and to seize the opportunities, the better for you. So I want to congratulate all of you because this evening you took the first step in your very important decision to understand China and China-Singapore relations better by coming here. So well done. So give yourself an applause.
Greg, may I have your permission to bring this forum to a close? I want to once more thank Councillor Tsai, who had to go off early. So Yuan Yuan, you did very well representing him. Please give Yuan Yuan a round of applause. I would also like to thank my good friend Sin Teck, who had to leave the newsroom and reporting so many breaking news about the election to spend this evening with us. Let's give Sin Teck a round of applause. And finally, I would like to thank my good friend Stanley Low, our brilliant young ambassador in Beijing, for a very good presentation and for answering your questions so candidly and substantively, and for his parting words of wisdom to you. So thank you all very much for coming. Thank you.